a couple who've got learning disabilities, you know, wanting to have a relationship or just be a friend. And people, oh dear, this is going to be very difficult. But why shouldn't they? They have rights, they have feelings, they have passions. And so, yes, we want the education to help them to be safe, but not just to be safe. We want them to have active lives and happy lives and fulfilled lives. The Shepherd's School here in Nottingham caters for about 106 pupils with severe and profound learning difficulties.
Could all the boys go to Sarah? Boys to Sarah?
Stand up if you're a boy.
Can the boys go to Sarah?
You can't.
Aruce is not a boy.
That's it.
Right, boys to Sarah. Right. Can I have girls on this side?
Yeah.
Come on then. That's it. And girls on this side. That's it.
No,
that's it. Boys on that side. And girls on this side. When I first came to the Shepherd School, this was quite a long time ago, and we had just begun to do sex and relationship education sessions, and it was very difficult. It was quite embarrassing to say words such as masturbation, etc.
We talk a lot about how do children learn. So we get people to think about their own learning, how do they learn about sex and relationship education themselves, and then think about the lives of young people with learning disabilities and where those gaps are, and therefore why the importance of providing more formal education within school. We run a lot of parent meetings, which we have for the last 20 or so years. And if I say in the last 20, 25 years, no parent has ever withdrawn their child. So first of all, I want this first exercise, how we learnt about sex and relationship education.
I just remember it being just a giggly mess.
Yes.
Sex education at school.
Yes, it was all mostly about the actual act, not emotions and safety and all the other issues.
It was mostly through, like, girly mags, you know, the help columns and stuff. When I was sort of like 12 years old, about people who were like 16 and what to do about sex.
The thing that's particularly good about doing it with our students is that you can see the real need for them to do it, and it's really important for them, you know, as growing young women, that they are aware of certain issues and that they protect themselves when they are out there in the adult world.
That picture of two hands together.
Holding hands.
Where did we say that was? Did we say holding hands with boyfriend or friend?
Friend.
My boyfriend.
Probably.
Sometimes in Lizzie hold it.
Yeah. When you're younger, you hold hands with your friends and things. But as you get older, it's more likely to hold hands with your boyfriend. Yeah.
I started at school last year. I was quite excited by the life skills, personal and social education, because I think it's really important. It's one of the key issues that the students need to learn about.
You go and stand at the bus stop. You can see the buses coming. But you stood there thinking, goodness me, I need to go to the toilet. So what Andrew's going to do, he's going to run as fast as he can through Victoria Centre to the toilet. He's got to the toilet, he goes in, goes to the toilet. He's coming out and this man comes up to him and says, have you got 5 minutes to spare?
No.
What do you think of that? Someone in the toilet asking if you've got 5 minutes to spare with them.
We told with a security.
Right. What do you think they might want?
Call the police.
Call the police? I think that'd be a fantastic idea, Thomas.
What?
Calling the police if somebody was asking you if you'd spend time in the toilet with them.
I wouldn't.
You wouldn't? That's really good.
Yeah.
As an NQT, I found it quite daunting to start teaching SRE to a group of sixth formers, but the school's particularly supportive, and there's a lot of material and a lot of very experienced staff that can support you.
Adam, do you think that's a normal thing to happen, somebody asking you if you've got some time to spare with them in the toilet?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
Do people ask you if you spend time in the toilet with them?
No.
No, they don't?
No, they don't.
I'm pleased about that.
No.
I'm very pleased about that.
No.
The actual sex act is just one very small part of this. If that's all it was, it would be very, very easy. This is about emotions, about behaviours, relationships, just the whole development of the body, respect and dignity. It's massive. It's a lifetime's programme that we're starting. We're sowing the seeds whilst they're at school, but this is a programme that needs to continue right throughout their lives. It needs to start young. It needs to start at the nursery. They need to know about their bodies. They need to know about valuing and dignity and respect and modesty. And they need to know about choice making.
Action, man! Let's
have a look! We actually devised our own curriculum, which is based on finding out about your body, social skills, sexual skills, but it's all on practical activities. You don't have to understand any language to be involved. Ronan, what do you think about this one? Shall I tell you what I think?
No.
I think it's a lady's head on a man's body. That's what I think, look. I think it's a lady's head on a man's body. Can I have a man? That's right. Can you give me a man, Arusa? A man, good girl, Arusa. Can you give me a man, Nathan?
Okay. Oh, thank you,
Arusa. Could you give me a man, Harley? Thank you. Ben, sit here next to me.
Harley?
Is it a girl or a boy?
You're right there.
Is it a girl?
That's good.
Yeah, it's a girl.
This isn't something you're going to do in a term, or in some cases, oh, we only do this in year 9 or year 13 or something like that. This is ongoing and has to be constant. So certainly looking at the body, the development of the body. Am I a boy? Am I a girl? Hugely important.
We're going to have to wash them to make sure they're clean.
No!
Aren't you going to wash yours?
They washed them because we hoped that this would help them to pay more attention to the different details on the body, which some people did wash the specific parts of the body, which we were quite pleased about. But that was if they hadn't noticed before, it gave them the extra opportunity to do that.
And what about this one? Is this a boy or a girl?
No.
It's a what?
No.
A girl, is it? Right, okay. I think this is a boy. Is that a girl or a boy?
A girl.
That's right, you're right. And how do you know it's a girl?
I can feel her.
You can feel her hair.
We wanted to know how they were identifying girls and boys. Was it because they got ribbons in their hair? Was it because they got boy parts or girl parts? But I don't think they were paying a lot of attention to the particular parts.
Let's can see. You find the boy?
You
which is the boy?
I don't think wants to feel him. Which one's the boy?
Yeah.
This one. Well That's done, you right. pointed, didn't you? You hold on to that boy then, Nathan.
Okay. What about you? Yeah. Is that a boy or a girl? What is it? Shall I tell her?
Let's have a look
Shall
at
I
it.
Tell her what it is?
Have a look, Harley, look in.
I'm going to tell her.
We used the correct terms. We had hoped that children would use the terms that they used at home to perhaps describe body parts, for example, Willy or whatever, but they didn't, so we thought it was a good opportunity to let them hear the correct words.
This is a girl baby because it's got a vagina. That's called a vagina. Just there. Can you see? And this is a boy because he's got a penis. Right.
Somebody was actually observing throughout so that we didn't have to concentrate and record. So at the end of the session, we would actually analyse everything that we've got and know exactly where people are to move on to the next session.
People will often say, oh, we would like to do sex education in a school, but the parents won't like it, they won't approve. If you work with the parents right from the start and explain why you're doing this, this is about giving information to people, it's about keeping them safe, it's also helping them to lead fulfilled lives. That's what every parent wants for their child. If you explain it in the right way. And actually, of course, a lot of the work we do in sex and relationship education is so broad. It's about living. Do you think having meetings with school and are helpful, like we are today, sort of that opportunity to talk with other parents?
It's helpful because I think as a parent it makes you feel more confident to tackle any issues you may come across at home. You're not sort of going blind.
Yes. Mm.
These things have been discussed, so it gives you that bravery to challenge something that you might come across with your youngster. Yeah.
Parents have mostly been really, really positive about what we're doing, partly because the students themselves are very positive about what we're doing, and so they go home and talk about what we've been covering. We always ensure that parents know what we're doing because they see the students themselves going home and talking about things, or just in general becoming more sort of confidence, women, young women with greater self-esteem, which is what this group really is all about. Today, all about friends and boyfriends. See if you know
your friend.
What the difference is. Any more guesses at some of the things I might have in here you might do with your friend or your boyfriend?
I sleep in my house.
Sleep at your house. That's really good. I think I have got one about a house here. I haven't so much got sleeping at a house. I've got going to a house.
How to someone's house.
Going to someone's house.
I think if you were to ask many young people, and indeed adults with learning disabilities and indeed other disabilities, do you go for tea at other people's houses? Are you invited for sleepovers? And generally the answer would be no. They miss out on so many of the normal social learning areas that we just take for granted.
Would you go to your friend's house?
Mm-hmm. I'll go to Nicholas' house.
Mm-hmm. Yes. You go to your friend's house. Would you go to your boyfriend's house, Jennifer? Yeah. So you might go to your boyfriend's house and you might go to your friend's house.
Most of the learning we had around sex and relationship was not what we had at school. It's about what we learned from our friends, what we were able to read, what we saw on the television. If you can't read, if you can't distinguish what's being said on the television, if you don't have those opportunities to go for sleepovers and whatever, where is your learning coming from? How important, therefore, it is that the schools provide that education.
So, me and Patricia, imagine I'm setting the scene. We're out on the schoolyard, okay? Yeah. And we're friends.
Yeah.
Yeah, Patricia?
I'm fine, I'm a bit tired today. They didn't sleep very well last
night. Didn't you?
No, not really.
Hey, guess what happened last night?
What?
My mum came in and she said that you can come and stay over.
Really?
I asked her about it on Friday.
Brilliant. I really want to go and stay at your house. That would be fantastic.
You're a really good mate of mine, you know.
Yeah, I really like spending time with you.
Yeah, I really want to go and do stuff with you.
That's really good.
I really like talking to you. Anyway, so I'll see you in a bit, yeah?
Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah. See you later
then. See
ya. Okay, bye.
What was I? Was I being a friend or was I being a boyfriend?
Boyfriend.
I was being a friend, right? What sort of things was I doing as a friend? What was I talking to Patricia about?
Like
sleepover, yeah. Yeah, we want to go out to each other's for tea. Was I touching Patricia anywhere?
Yeah.
No.
And the breast?
Was I touching her there when I was doing that?
No,
because I was being a friend, okay? Out on the yard again. It's Mary, it's Patricia. You all right, Patricia?
Yes, I'm fine, thanks.
Oh, God. Missed you as a mate. Anyway, you had a good night last night?
I stayed in, it was quite good.
Yeah. Oh, that's good,
yeah.
You've got such nice legs as well. I really like that. Yeah. Oh, you're gorgeous. Look at your hair. I really like you as a friend. You're dead nice. We're best mates, we are.
I'm not sure.
Yeah?
If somebody does come along who is potentially sexually abusive and you have no friends and you're very, very lonely, then that makes you far more vulnerable to being a target if someone is to be abusive.
Got some this for you. For at the garden.
That's really
just
nice.
Just to say you're a really good mate.
Thank
you. Yeah?
I'm not sure how I feel like this. What do you think this is okay?
No.
Do you think this is okay? I'm not sure what I should do here. She's been touching. Do you think that's all right, or do you think I should?
Say something
to Mary.
I want to tell you something. I love you.
Oh!
What do
Do you think I should?
No.
What should I do?
No.
Stop her.
You should do
friend's hair.
Touch Patricia's hair because it's mixing not allowed.
It's not allowed.
Mixing it.
I didn't feel very, very comfortable with that, really, yeah. Mary, when you were touching my legs and touching my hair and
I'm sorry,
touching my arm.
I got confused there. I'm really sorry. Shall we just sort of sit and chat then?
Yeah, that would be much better.
So who should I give the flower to?
Boyfriend,
yeah.
Often the young women are more comfortable with talking to each other as a group of young women, and they see that as an identity group, and they can explore things in the privacy of that group.
They're the sixth form men's group, and they're from a variety of classes in the sixth form.
Are you happy for me to tie this on your head?
Yeah. Okay.
So already Ahmed's trusting me to tie this on his head.
I started off with them wearing blindfolds as an exercise to get them to start trusting each other and feel comfortable with each other, sort of a group building exercise, which is really important, so they feel happy with their peers and perhaps more willing to talk to each other about the things, the issues we're going to cover. The aim of the session were to get the students to recognise who they trusted in their lives, in their own sort of community, I suppose. And to give them experience of perhaps being in situations when it's safe and they can start to make those decisions before they do have to make them in real life.
So, Andrew is out shopping in Nottingham. Can you see that? And this woman comes up to him and says,
I've got no money for my bus.
I'm not sure how it works.
Oh, well, no, but I need to get to work and I forgot to bring the money with me.
Let's just stop there. Jenny's just asking Andrew for some money for the bus. Would you give her the money, Andrew?
No, that work.
Would you give me some money?
No, Adam.
I don't trust her.
You don't trust
no,
her?
No.
Is that because of the way she looks, or is it just because she...
Where she looks.
Ooh. Where she looks?
Yeah.
That's very unkind.
That's not the
voice
to
know,
is it? OK, we're on to Jamie. Jamie, would you give Jenny money? You would?
Yeah.
That's very kind of you. Why would you do that? You don't know what she's going to spend it on yet. She says it's for the bus, but how do you know that's true? She might be going down the pub with it.
I just ask her to take me with her, won't I?
Just take you as well?
Yeah, have a nice drink.
And you'd go with her?
Yeah.
But you've never met her before.
Well, I don't really care.
Jamie. Yeah. We'll have a talk about that in a minute. You keep the money and say, no, I'm busy, and carry on walking.
Yeah, I care.
You give it her? Perhaps an idea, guys, to have a little think about where you would want your money to be spent, because it might be spent on drugs. Would you want your own money to be spent on drugs for somebody to take that could harm them? And Andrew's still shopping. He's come up to another guy. He's got his box in his hands. And he's wearing a badge on his neck. And it looks to me that he's just asking for money for a charity. I don't know which charity is. I can't quite read it from here. So look, it just says charity on it. I'm not sure it looks like Ahmed either.
I brought the charity person in as well as this person begging to just get them to think or compare two people asking for similar things in different ways and perhaps how they would judge that. Is it on how they look or what they're wearing? And that's particularly why I use the false card and get them to pick up on details. Like, have you checked it? They are who they say they are.
Is this guy asking for money for charity? Are you going to give it to him?
No, I'm not.
You're not?
No, I'm out.
But it's going to go to a good cause this time. It's not going to go anywhere you wouldn't want it to. You know where it's going, obviously. He's obviously in a charity.
I'm not food.
You're just going for your food, so you'd say no?
No.
Jamie, what would you do? You wouldn't. But you would the last person. The person that might take it to the pub and spend your money on a nice pint of beer that... when you could have gone out and bought something else with it that you wanted. Daniel, would you give Ahmed the money?
No.
No. Thomas?
I wouldn't.
You wouldn't?
No.
Todd?
Yeah.
You would? Now, Todd, he's wearing this ID card, but it doesn't even look like him. This card doesn't even match. Would you not check? You not think, oh, something looks a bit fishy about this guy? You still give him this money? you put it in the pot?
Looking at safety, you know, can you say no if you don't want something? Do you think your body's valuable? Because if we haven't done work on valuing yourself, if somebody tries to do something, you don't, perhaps you let it happen because, you know, you don't value it. Giving people choices, huge part of the curriculum. So again, if we're saying in the nursery whether a child's choosing whether they're going to have milk or orange, hugely important, because if at 18 or 19 you go to college and someone's trying to, at the back of the bicycle shed's trying to get you to do something, do you know you can say no? You know, because if no one's given you choice-making skills, you don't suddenly learn them.
Who are you waiting for?
My brother.
Your brother? Adam's brother's going to pick him up. Adam's waiting. And this lady pulls up in the car, saying that, would you like a lift?
No.
No. Why not?
Good lad.
It's not trust her.
You don't trust her?
No.
But this lady looks quite kind. She's offered you a lift. She not, you can't trust her?
No.
So, what if it was a man that pulled up in this car?
Walk away and, yeah, as far as me, you know, he will drag me in the car and, yeah.
Does this person want to hurt you, do you think?
Yeah.
Some of our students in this school are particularly vulnerable and do need to know about some of the harsher realities of what might happen to them when they're out on their own. And I think it's good to try and run through those situations in a safe environment.
Pretend that you're in the shower. You're going to stand in the right one.
That's your Jamie.
You're going in that one, Jamie. Thomas, you're going to go in the other one?
I'm far end.
Far end? That one's on the far end, isn't it? You're standing that one. Ahmed, where are you going to go?
That end.
What are you going to do?
There's two showers.
Oh. You're going to go in as well?
No! Not with me!
There's only two showers in. There's three people. What's going to happen? What should happen?
You should wait. You wait.
You're going to wait?
Yeah.
Ahmed can't just nip in with Jamie or Thomas and have a shower as well?
It'd be awful.
So
Thomas.
We can't have more than one person in one shower cubicle for a start. You're happy to have a shower now? There's not so many of you.
No, I wasn't.
Why?
Don't you want to hit you with this?
Does that help?
Yeah.
Does that
help?
That is help, doesn't it, Jay?
Doors are shut.
Shut the doors.
Shut the doors. It's a good idea, isn't it?
Yeah.
No.
Why are we going to shut the doors?
No.
Nobody see us.
They don't want people to see, right?
Oh.
The men seem to enjoy being a group of men, and they seem just to talk more willingly and more openly as those groups, and they identify with those groups. And obviously there are certain issues which are more particular to being female or being male, and there are other issues which they could perhaps explore together, and they do on occasion meet together and explore issues together.
When someone starts to say, oh, we must think about them as a sexual being, it's quite a lot to take on board. But it's really important that we do. We have children with multiple disabilities. They too are sexual beings. So you may have a 16-year-old who is functioning at a very young level in many aspects of their life, but sexually they are perfectly the same as everybody else and will have some of those feelings racing around their bodies. So we have done a lot of work in terms of supporting staff and supporting families to come to terms with that. And that's really important for the youngster. So we respect the fact that they may be functioning at a young age, but also respect the fact that they are 16.
One of the students particularly wanted to do some work about boyfriends, so we try and respond to that.
Victoria, what did you say you wanted to do some work about?
Sets and good-looking and dates.
That's right. Somebody who was sexy and good-looking and she went on dates with. I think it was a boy.
Boyfriend.
I think it was... Is that right, Victoria? Boyfriends.
Yes.
Yeah.
In most sessions, we have a sort of general input session, and then we perhaps do some role play, and then perhaps do some work with symbols and writing afterwards, so that's a reminder to them of the things that they've learned.
We try to make it their curriculum, but some of the things that we touch upon, particularly in the drama and things, are actually situations that happen within the sixth form. So if we notice something happening on the playground, we'll tend to bring it in and do some drama with it, and kind of see what their responses are, and then take them through why that might not be a good idea, or what things you could do in place of it, really. So Thomas, well born, asks Danielle, you go out with me? Imagine this, Danielle. Danielle says, yes. And they're going out. So what can they do together?
Kissing.
They can kiss. Where can they kiss?
Yeah.
lips and the lips. Wherever. Cheeks. Well, yeah. What about Thomas? He's sitting next to Danielle, like me and Patricia were.
Like, touch.
And he comes and strokes Danielle's hair.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Both said that they want to be girlfriend and boyfriend. Yeah, that's okay. They're going out. Yeah. Is it okay for if Danielle invites Thomas over to her house?
Yeah.
Thomas is walking down the street and wants to hold Danielle's hand. Is that all right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The group themselves feel they trust each other,
which then sets the atmosphere for them being comfortable to talk to each other and to female staff about any issues which might happen to them at any time, because issues don't just happen in PSHE sessions, they happen out on the bus and out in the community. Farina said something about a bedroom.
Bedroom.
Like sleepover. You might go on a sleepover.
A boyfriend and girlfriend. Yeah. Those two sleep together.
They might, when you're a bit older, perhaps.
Yeah.
By not knowing about things, they're making themselves more vulnerable. By knowing about things, they've had a chance to explore some ideas and to explore, you know, some of the good things and also some of the less good things.
Do you know
what that is?
I don't know this one.
Farina's peeping at a word here, which you've just been talking a bit about over there.
Boyfriend or like girlfriend. Boyfriend.
Something that you might talk about.
A bed?
Friends.
Mm.
Yeah.
On the bed?
You might talk about sex on the bed with your boyfriend.
The negative impact of having no sex and relationship education or not getting that bit right, if you like, supersede everything else on the curriculum. So you're talking about people's lives, basically, and so the potential to make a difference is enormous. Yeah.